Hello, friends, and welcome to my Sunday school class. The title for my class is Isaac Blesses Jacob, okay? And let's look at our lesson overview, okay? Here's the central truth of our lesson. God's plan for humanity will be fully realized despite the sinfulness of the people. Amen? And the focus for our class today is acknowledge that God is sovereign over human affairs and trust in his perfect plan. What does sovereignty mean? He doesn't have to consult anybody. He's the creator of the entire universe. So whatever he decides to do, that's exactly what happens. Amen? So that's his sovereignty. And then evangelism emphasis, God graciously forgave any confessed sin. All right. And now here's the golden text coming from Genesis chapter 25 and verse 23. The Lord said unto Rebekah, two nations are in thy womb, and two manner of people shall be separated from thy bowels. And the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. Hallelujah! All right, let's go to a worship song, and y'all can worship along with me, okay? It's been pre-recorded. All right.
Of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. Jehovah Nisi, Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace, and I worship you because of who you are.
Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and sing. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you and we praise you, for you are an awesome God. You are Jehovah Jireh, the Lord God, my provider. And you provide for all my need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Thank you that you are Jehovah Rapha, the Lord God, my healer. For he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. Thank you that you are Jehovah Shalom, the Lord God, my peace. And you have told us not to be anxious about anything, but by prayers, with supplications, and with thanksgiving, to make our requests known unto God. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard our hearts and our minds by Christ Jesus. Thank you that you are Jehovah Nisi, the Lord God, our victory. Hallelujah. For the battle is not mine, but the battle is the Lord's. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, that you are Jehovah Rohi, the Lord God, my shepherd. I shall not want. You make me to lie down in green pastures. Lead me beside the still waters. You restore my soul. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you that you are Jehovah Sidkenu, the Lord God, my righteousness. For all my self-righteousness is like filthy rags, but I put on the righteousness of your dear Son, Jesus. For he who knew no sin became sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. So we praise you, we worship you, we magnify your name, Lord. Thank you that you are in control of every situation and every circumstance in our life. You have promised us you'll never leave us, you'll never forsake us, you go with us always, even unto the end of the world. And Father, now I come to you for my Sunday school class, Lord. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto you, O Lord, my Savior and my Redeemer. Guard my mouth and my tongue to say only those things you want me to say and those things that you want your people to hear, Father. And I'll be sure to give you the praise, to give you the glory, to give you the honor. For we ask it in Jesus' matchless name. Amen and amen. Okay. All right. Let's go to the introduction of our class. The divine promise offered to Abraham and Sarah is the theme that holds the patriarchal narratives together. Now, who are the patriarchs? Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right? They and their descendants become the agents of God's promise. Therefore, the story of each patriarch continues and builds upon the former promises. Regardless of conflict, alienation, and various other threats, the promise prevails and is fulfilled. Hallelujah! How many of y'all realize that Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, they came from dysfunctional families, messed up families, but in spite of the conflict, in spite of the alienation and various other threats, the promise prevails and is fulfilled. Amen. So if God has given you a promise, you better hang on to it and don't give up. You know, it might be just round the corner. All right. Accordingly, the promise offers a hopeful future to Abraham and his descendants. Amen? Okay. The Jacob literature is similar to the Abrahamic narrative, but it also diverges from it in major ways. Like Abraham, God appears to Jacob and speaks promises and blessing. For example, Genesis 28, 13 through 14. And chapter 35, 9 through 12, and chapter 46, 3 through 4. And we don't have the time to turn there right now, but y'all can look them up later. And despite poor judgment and moral blunders, God intervenes and protects Jacob as he did with Abraham. How awesome is that? However, while the narrative of Abraham focuses on God's covenantal promise of an heir, the Jacob story concentrates on the promise of land. Okay? Now, while conflict is evident in the story of Abraham, it is not as significant as in the experience of Jacob. However, conflict runs through Jacob's narrative. The story of chapter 27 revolves around the motifs of blessing and is developed through four characters we're going to talk about, right? Isaac, his wife Rebecca, and their two sons, Esau and Jacob. The theme of blessing is so significant in this ancient culture that two of the story's characters, Rebecca and Jacob, resort to trickery to obtain the blessing they believe is owed to Jacob, see 25 and 23. Wow. How sad is that? Okay. How sad it is when you try to make things happen. You know, the promise was true, but they did not wait on God's timing. And we saw that in the case of Abraham. God had promised him a seed and had shown Abraham that his descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky. But after so many years of waiting, Sarah got impatient and she had Abraham have a son through her maidservant Hagar. And what a mess that created. And that mess is still going on between the Jews and the Muslims today. Amen? Amen? Okay. All right. Clearly, the blessing is not simply a meaningless ritual because neither son wants to live without his father's blessing. Yet we see the blessing is delivered through clever deception. How ignorant is that? But sometimes we are all guilty of doing things like that, right? We don't want to wait. We're such an impatient people. We're living in a microwave society. I want it and I want it right now. Oops. Chapter 27 progresses the story of Esau and Jacob, which began in chapter 25, 19 through 34. There we learn of their conflict that began in the womb, their distinctive physical appearance and character, the reason for their names, Isaac's and Rebekah's feelings for each son, and how Esau sold his birthright to Jacob for a bowl of bean soup. Oh, wow, Lord. Isn't that what people are doing these days? They're selling their inheritance for a bowl of bean soup, for a few moments of momentary pleasure, for a few moments of fame and pride and arrogance. But what they don't seem to realize is they are giving up their inheritance. You can't have both of them together. Amen? Okay. And this is a warning for all of us, especially in the day and age that we're living in, that we do not sell our birthright for a bowl of bean soup. Amen? For just momentary gains, financial gains or physical gains or any such thing. Amen. Most significantly, we learn God promised to fulfill the covenant he made with Abraham and Isaac through Jacob and not Esau. in the ancient culture of Israel, certain privileges and rights were naturally granted to the firstborn son. However, God announced before the twins' birth that Esau, the firstborn son, would serve his younger brother. Why was that so? Isn't that unfair of God? Wait a minute. He's a sovereign God. He can do whatever he wants. And he works things out together for our good somehow, even through the bad stuff. Amen? And we should never forget that. Okay? Chapter 27 shows how God's promise concerning Jacob was fulfilled through deception. Since our lesson examines the interaction between blessing and deceit, consider the significance of blessing in ancient Israel. The words bless and blessing occur 28 times in Genesis 26. Chapter 3 through Genesis chapter 28, verse 4. Usually, God was the agent of blessing, but human beings could also impart a blessing. The person bestowing the blessing had the power to dramatically alter the future of the individual receiving the blessing. An individual's destiny was not created by weapons and wars, but by symbolic language and gestures. The blessing was a symbolic gripping and life-changing act that bound the older generation with the younger generation. In the case of Esau and Jacob, the blessing was envied and secured by shrewd deceit. Aha! The older generation was meant to bless the younger generation. But we're in a day and age where the younger generation despises the older generation. And that's simply because of the culture we live in. And many a times children have not been treated well by the fathers. So there have been father wounds to deal with. And so naturally, the children grow up sometimes hating their parents, hating their fathers. But that should not be the case. Amen? Because your parents, your fathers and your mothers can be a source of generational blessing to you. Hallelujah! All right. Now, let's go to point number one and go to our scriptures. Point number one, plot to deceive Isaac. And the subheading is Isaac plans to bless Esau. Genesis 27, 1 through 5. Okay. So let's go to Genesis 27, 1 through 5. And before we do that, just a quick scripture overview. Point number one, we're going to talk about the plot to deceive Isaac. Genesis 27, 1 through 13. Point number two, Isaac deceived and Jacob blessed. Genesis 27, 14 through 29. And point number three, a deceiver revealed, Genesis 27, 30 through 46. So all of our scriptures are coming from the chapter of Genesis 27, okay? In case you want to look them up, okay? All right. So point number one, plot to deceive Isaac. Isaac plans to bless Esau. Genesis 27, 1 through 5. Now it came to pass when Isaac was old and his eyes were so dim that he could not see that he called Esau, his older son, and said to him, "My son," and he answered him, "Here I am." Then he said, "Behold, now I'm old. I do not know the day of my death." Okay? And here is Isaac talking to his eldest son, Esau. Remember that Esau was Isaac's favorite, and Jacob was his wife's, Rebekah's favorite, okay? And whenever you have favoritism in a family, it always leads to confusion. Okay. Okay. Now, therefore, please take your weapons, your quiver and your bow, and go out to the field and hunt game for me, and make me savory food, such as I love, and bring it to me, that I may eat, that my soul may bless you before I die. Aha! Here is Isaac planning to bless Esau just before he died. And so he's asking Esau to bring him some savory food, the kind that he loves. We all know that Esau was a hunter, and Jacob was just an ordinary person, okay? All right. So Rebekah was listening when Isaac spoke to Esau, his son, and Esau went to the field to hunt game and to bring it. Ah, Esau was a hunter, and so Esau went out into the field to hunt game for his dad so he could cook him a meal with that game. But Rebekah was eavesdropping, and she was planning and conniving behind the scenes, trying to manipulate things to happen the way she wanted them to happen. How sad is that? How sad is that? Ah, that's so very sad. All right. Isaac was old, partially sighted, and near death. The phrase, his eyes were dim, is a figure of speech used to illustrate an individual's physical, emotional, spiritual frailty. Additionally, by mentioning Isaac's blindness, the narrator prepares us for the events that are about to unfold. Since Isaac was approaching his death, he believed it was the appropriate time to settle his affairs by giving his blessing and inheritance to the rightful heir. To formalize the occasion of blessing, he summoned his oldest son, Esau, and requested he prepared an appetizing meal for him. Why was Isaac blessing Esau and not Jacob? Did not God say the covenantal promise he made with Abraham would be accomplished through Jacob? Ah, that's a good question. Is it because Isaac favored Esau over Jacob? Oops. Would Rebekah have kept God's word concerning the twins from Isaac? Wow, these are good questions. And we don't really know the answer, but maybe, just maybe, Rebekah did not let Isaac know what God had revealed to her, that the younger would obtain the blessing instead of the older. Maybe. And there's no definite proof in there. So let's go on, all right? The text does not answer any of these questions. What matters is that Isaac was eager to bestow the patriarchal blessing to Esau, who had sold his birthright to Jacob for a bowl of bean soup, for a bowl of stew. Chapter 25, verses 27 through 34. Esau was just as eager to receive his father's blessing as he went out to hunt for food. We read an interesting detail. Rebekah, Isaac's wife, had overheard the private conversation between Isaac and Esau. What does this passage reveal about the relationship between Isaac and Rebekah? What can we learn from this? Aha! The relationship was probably, in my opinion, not very good, because they were trying to compete with one another and instead of cooperate. Amen? And I always tell God that in a marriage, you know, you have the husband, you have the wife, and you have God. As each one gets closer to God, they get closer to each other. So maybe one was closer to God than the other. But they really didn't have a very good relationship with each other, as it turns out, as it seems, okay? That's my opinion, all right? Now, let's go on. Point number B, Rebekah plots to deceive Isaac. Okay, all right. Let's go on with the scriptures. Rebekah plots to deceive Isaac. So Rebekah spoke to Jacob, her son, saying, "Indeed, I hear your father speak to Esau, your brother, saying, 'Bring me game and make savory food for me. I may eat it and bless you in the presence of the Lord before God, before my death.'" Okay. "Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice according to what I command you. Go now to the flock and bring me from there 2 choice kids of the goats, and I will make savory food from them for your father, such as he loves. Then you shall take it to your father, that he may eat it, and that he may bless you before his death." And Jacob said to Rebekah's mother, "Look, Esau, my brother, is a hairy man, and I'm a smooth-skinned man. Perhaps my father will feel me. I shall seem to be a deceiver to him. I shall bring a curse upon me and not a blessing." But his mother said to him, "Let your curse be on me, my son. Only obey my voice and go and get them for me." Wow, do you see the manipulation? Aha. And poor Esau was trying to do right, and his mother was so wanting him to receive the blessing that she was trying her level best to manipulate this situation. And that was so sad. That was so sad, okay? Isaac was old, partially sighted, and near death. Rebekah plots to deceive Isaac. Discovering Isaac's intention to bless Esau, Rebekah devised a plot to foil the blessing of Esau and to ensure that her son, Jacob, received the blessing, verse 6. She was the one whom God spoke directly about each son's destiny. She knew the rights and privileges of the blessing and inheritance must go to Jacob, not Esau. Therefore, she would do whatever it took to ensure God's word was accomplished concerning Jacob. These verses depict Rebekah was a shrewd, decisive, and commanding woman. Aha! But that was exactly what got her and her son into so much trouble. Although Rebekah had a well-thought-out plan, Jacob objected to her subterfuge. Jacob did not protest because he believed the notion of deceiving his own father was reprehensible, but because he was afraid of getting caught while deceiving Isaac. This shows that there was a dark and unethical side to Jacob. Help us, Lord. Jacob was a manipulator. He was a schemer at heart. Okay? Nevertheless, Rebekah was confident her plan would be successful for Jacob to obey her instructions. Yet if something went wrong with her scheme, she would take the blame. Rebekah's strong love for Jacob is summarized in the words of Agatha Christie. "A mother's love for a child is like nothing else in the world. It knows no law, no pity. It dares all things and crushes down remorselessly all that stands in its path." While we cannot deny Rebekah's love for Jacob was boundless, we must not forget that she readily cheated her other son, Esau, from his blessing. Let's go on. We come to this heading called Despise Deception. What do we learn from all this? Saints not only desire to love and speak truth with their lips, but they seek to be true within. They will not lie even in the closet of their hearts. For God is there to listen. They scorn double meaning, evasions, equivocations, white lies, flatteries, and deceptions. This is by Charles Spurgeon. Wow. So there should be a distinct difference between a truth and a lie. There is no such thing as a half-truth. A half-truth is a full lie. Wow. Help us, Lord. Help us. You know, and we sometimes, you know, forget these things because we think, it's not, no big deal. It's not a big deal, you know. But the Bible says all liars will have their end in the lake of fire. Ooh. Yoo-hoo. Whoops. Okay. All right. Let's go on. Then the next thing we talk about is Isaac deceived. Genesis 27, 14 through 24. Okay. So let's go to Genesis 27, 14 through 24. Genesis 27, 14 through 24. All right. Isaac deceived, Jacob blessed. And he went and got them and brought them to his mother. And his mother made savory food such as his father loved. Then Rebekah took the choice clothes of her elder son Esau, which were with her in the house, and put them on Jacob, her younger son. Wow, look at all the deceptions that she has to go through. And you know the problem with one lie is, it never ends with one lie. You have to say several lies to cover that lie, and so on and so forth, okay? So it never ends. And she put the skins of the kids of the goats on his hand and on the smooth part of his neck. Then she gave the savory food and the bread which she had prepared into the hand of her son Jacob. Uh-oh. So he went to his father and said, "My father," and he said, "Here I am." "Who are you, my son?" Jacob said to his father, "I am Esau, your firstborn." Liar. He was lying through his teeth. "I have done just as you told me. Please arise, sit, and eat of my game that your soul may bless me." My game? Jacob, you're a tent dweller. You're not a hunter. You didn't get to kill that game. See, one lie leads to another, and it never ends. Aha. Okay, so let's look at these scriptures and see in more detail what they're talking about, okay? Driven by his own selfish desire for the blessing, Jacob conspires with his mother to deceive his father and steal the blessing from his brother. These verses also describe Rebekah's carefully considered and detailed course of action to deceive Isaac. She cooks the meal to make sure it is prepared just the way Isaac likes it. Then to account for the physical differences between Jacob and Esau, She dresses Jacob in Esau's best clothes, places goatskin on the bare skin of Jacob's arms and neck, verses 14 through 16 NIV. And interestingly, Hebrew word for smooth, verse 16, is used metaphorically in Proverbs 26, flattering to mean deception, which is what Jacob employs to gain the blessing. He implements his mother's plan to deceive his father in order to achieve his own desires. When Jacob takes the food to Isaac, he unflinchingly tells his father four lies. Lie number one, he claims to be Esau, Genesis 27:19. Lie number two, says he has done exactly as he had been instructed by Isaac, verse 19. That was a lie. And then point number three, he cites God for his quick and successful hunting trip, verse 20. And four, he assures Isaac that he is indeed Esau. Note a couple of points in this passage. First, Jacob refers to God as the Lord your God, New King James Version, and not my God. Jacob's reference indicated the Lord Yahweh was the God of Isaac, but not yet the God of Jacob. Second, since both Rebekah and Jacob had engaged in lies and deceit, why were they never rebuked by God? Were they justified in the acts of deception? Rebekah was aware of God's promise concerning Jacob, and she knew Isaac aimed to give the promise of blessing to Esau. Furthermore, Esau did not value his birthright, for he had already sold it to Jacob. However, these reasons were not sufficient grounds for Rebekah and Jacob's lies and deceit. See how sometimes we can rationalize the truth with lies. Amen? We can rationalize things. Proverbs 6:13 and 14 says, "Who winks maliciously with his eye, who plots evil with deceit in his heart, he always stirs up conflict." That's from the NIV version. Do you know of anybody that always stir up conflict? Something to think about and repent. Rebekah had already received God's promise to Jacob. Rather than taking the matter into her own hands, she should have prayed as she had done before and waited for God to fulfill his word concerning her sons. By taking charge of Jacob's destiny, she created a bitter conflict between her two sons that lasted for over 20 years. And another lesson we learn from all this is whatever you sow, you reap. There are consequences to what you do. And we know the consequences were really bad for Jacob. And he had to flee to his uncle Laban's house. And then Laban deceived him for 14 years. Amen? So what goes around comes around. Jacob the deceiver was deceived by Laban the master deceiver. How sad. Okay, let's go on, all right? Point number B, Jacob blessed. And he came near and kissed him, and he smelled the smell of his raiment and blessed him and said, "See, the smell of my son is as the smell of a field which the Lord had blessed." Okay, so let's turn to our scriptures and look at these scriptures, okay? And we're kind of running out of time. Then his father Isaac said to him, "Come near now and kiss me, son," okay? And he came near and kissed him, and he smelled the smell of his clothing and blessed him and said, "Surely the smell of my son is like the smell of a field the Lord has blessed. Therefore, may God give you of the dew of the heaven of the fatness of the earth and plenty of grain and wine. So Jacob is blessed by his father Isaac, okay? And he steals the blessing. And we're kind of running out of time, guys, so pardon me if I rush through the last part. And so Jacob is blessed, Genesis 27, 25, and 29. Let people serve you and nations bow down to you. Be master over your brethren and let your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you, and blessed be those who bless you. So Jacob is blessed, okay? Now, all right, let's talk for a minute about crippling lies. A willful falsehood told is not able to stand by itself without another to support it. It's easy to tell a lie, but hard to tell only one. Thomas Fuller, okay? And we've talked about that just a few minutes ago. One lie leads to another, leads to another. And you have to say a bunch of lies to cover up the very first lie. Okay, let's go on. A deceiver revealed the stolen blessing. Now, it happened as soon as Isaac had finished blessing Jacob, and Jacob had scarcely gone out from the presence of Isaac, his father. Esau's brother came in from his hunting. He also had made savory food and brought it to his father and said to his father, "Let my father, arise and eat of his son's game that your soul may bless me." So Esau has no clue what's gone on just a few minutes before he came in. And he's going to be very disappointed, and he's going to be a very, very angry man. Would you blame Esau for that? And his father Isaac said to him, "Who are you?" So he said, "I'm your son, your firstborn Esau." Then Isaac trembled exceedingly and said, "Who? Where is the one who hunted game and brought it to me? I ate all of it before you came. I blessed him, and indeed he shall be blessed." Wow. So the deception is finally uncovered. And very quickly, too. Then Isaac answered and said, "Esau, indeed I made him your master, and all his brethren I've given to him as servants with grain and wine. I have sustained him. What shall I do now for you, my son?" So Isaac finally realizes that he had blessed the wrong son. He had blessed Jacob instead of Esau. And Esau said to his father, "Have you only one blessing, my father? Bless me also, oh my father." And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. Then Isaac, his father, answered and said to him, "Behold, your dwelling shall be of the fatness of the earth and of the dew of heaven from above." Ah, so he blesses Esau also. "By your sword you shall live, and you shall serve your brother. Shall come to pass when you become restless, you shall break his yoke from your neck." So Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing with which his father blessed him. And Esau said in his heart, "The days of mourning for my father are at hand. Then I will kill my brother Jacob." Oh, hallelujah. Oh, how sad is that? Naturally, Esau was so mad. He said, "I'm going to wait till my dad passes away, and then I'm going to kill my brother Esau, for he stole my blessing." Wow. Can you imagine the amount of animosity the two of them, Isaac and Rebekah, created between their children, two children. It's bad enough that there's always sibling rivalry between two children. But now this inflamed the entire situation when Jacob stole Esau's blessing. Amen. And so let's go on. And the words of Esau, her older son, were told to Rebekah. So she sent and called Jacob, her younger son, said to him, "Surely your brother Esau comforts himself concerning you by intending to kill you." So she told her son Jacob, said, "You better get out of here, boy, because Esau is fixing to kill you. Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice. Arise, flee to my brother Laban in Haran." And so Jacob had to flee to Haran, amen, from his brother Esau. Collusion, conflict, and consequences. Let's come to the conclusion of this lesson, okay? We're going to talk about collusion, conflict, and consequences. When people collude together, like, you know, husband and wife, Rebecca and Isaac colluded, you know, Rebecca and her son Jacob colluded with each other and plotted to steal the blessing, had created conflict, and that had consequences. Hallelujah. Wow. There are always consequences for our sin. God forgives the sin, blots it out, but there are still consequences for our sin. Rebecca lost her son, for she would never see him again. Jacob was forced to leave his father's home in comfort. His relationship with his brother was destroyed, and he would not enjoy the benefits of the blessing anytime soon. When he left his father's home, he did not leave with wealth or property. And in Haran, he was certainly no ruler of nations, 27 and 29. Rather, Jacob lived in servitude to his uncle Laban for 20 years. Look at the price he paid for 20 years. He was a slave to his uncle Laban. Indeed, God will fulfill his purposes despite our sinful behavior. But our selfish actions can create bitter conflict and cause others to suffer. Oh God, help us, Lord. Help us never to do that. Amen. Rather than wait on God to accomplish his promises to Jacob and Esau, Rebecca and Jacob colluded to achieve God's purpose in their own way. Rebecca and Jacob's failure to wait on God mirrored Sarah and Abraham's impatient attitude towards God's promise for them. Consequently, both Rebecca and Jacob suffered greatly. Consequences. There are always consequences. Sins are forgiven, but there are always consequences to our sin. All right. And that brings us pretty much to the end of our lesson. Okay. And so let's go back to our worship song and end with that, okay?
Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, Jehovah Nissi, Lord. victory, Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace, and I worship you because of who you are. Jireh, my provider, Jehovah Nissi, Lord, you reign in victory, Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace, and I worship you. And I worship you because of who you are. And I worship you because of who you are.
Hallelujah! And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Thank you for listening. And if you like the broadcast, please put likes on it and share it with your friends. And if you're in this area and you don't have a home church to attend, please come to our church on 7 North Tuxedo Avenue, Hope City Church, Pastor Sibby Thomas. Hallelujah. So you're welcome. And services start at 10:30 in the morning. Thank you.